So welcome to the Small Business Festival. This is LinkedIn Business Brand Booster Blueprint for Women event on the 16th of August 2017. My name is Sue Ellson and it's my pleasure to be here. This is the third festival event that I've been involved in, the third year of festivals. Every year I run two because they sell out and I end up having to do another one. So some of the people who told me that they couldn't come this morning are coming next Thursday. So if you know somebody who's interested in this topic, I'm going to repeat the whole thing next Thursday at RMIT University. That particular event, I'll still talk about the women's stuff because there was people who couldn't book into this one who were going to that one. But I'm also going to have a focus on migrants because what I do is I help people who are new to Australia through Newcomers Network. So I really wanted to touch on some of the issues that are more specific to migrants in that particular LinkedIn presentation. So to give you a bit of background on me, I started work 6 days after my last Year 12 exam back in 1982, and then in 1987 I was stuck in front of a computer, and I've been pretty much self-taught to use a computer ever since. And so I'm not a geek, you know, I'm telling you now, but I managed to sort out a huge number of problems all myself, except QuickBooks Online. I seem to be having trouble with that, but anyway, that's another story, probably because I don't like accounting even though I'm good at it. And anyway, I stayed at Westpac until I moved to Melbourne in 1994, and as a result of the difficulty transitioning just from Adelaide, I set up Newcomers Network in 2001. So that's a website that I've had online since 2001. And I run a monthly event called Living, Working and Networking in Melbourne, which I've run for 11 years. And I've also hosted 11 Christmas Day picnic lunches, and I've got a research project coming up to do with newcomers and technology, supervised by, or assisted with, Swinburne University students. And I've also set up Camberwell Network, so tonight I'm running an event in Camberwell, also part of the Small Business Festival, but we meet on the third Wednesday every month and we gather around and talk about a particular topic, and I share those tips on the Campbell Network website. I also teach at the Centre for Adult Education, RMIT and Monash, and various other places as well. And last year I wrote 3 books, which you can see there, and I've got a special deal for you. And another really important component of who I am as a person is all the voluntary work I do. So you'll see that I've had a huge range of voluntary experience, and that's been really, really beneficial to my career. So don't ever underestimate the value you've got for your professional development through your voluntary work. And that's why I like to showcase it, because for me it's really important. Obviously I'm not paid for today either. And this is obviously another voluntary thing that I do and I love. The way I help people, just so you know up front, so that you don't feel like you're being sold to, as I said before, I go to between 1 and 4 events per week. So I hate it when they just don't tell you everything. Oh, that's in my book, that's in my course, that's in something else. So I'm here to actually tell you stuff today. But just so that you know, there's heaps of free information on my website, presentations, previous publications, podcasts. I've also got digital books, the paper books today. And I'm running an online course, so for people who want to actually have more interaction, they can do that. And then I also offer individual support as well as group support. So anybody who wants to buy just one book today, they're normally $40, it's $30. And if you want to buy all 3 books, it's normally $120, but you get it for $60. So that's your special deal for coming today. Plus the goodie bag, which is coming. But what you signed up for is what's written here. This is what was on the events page for this particular event. And I want to help you optimize your own LinkedIn profile, as well as your company profile. Select some of the right techniques that are going to be suitable for your particular purpose, regardless of what they are. And I'm really conscious that I've only got 90 minutes and I want to, you know, try and give you as much as I can in that time. Normally, when I run a little bit longer, I get everybody to introduce themselves. So if I can scoop through the information fairly quickly, I'd still really love to do that, because then you can at least know who else is in the room and get a bit of networking that way as well. Because face-to-face networking is still the best, you know. I absolutely believe it's the best thing to do. And in my third book, I talk about old techniques and new techniques and which ones work. And live events are really good because people get to meet you, and then if you connect with them on LinkedIn, then they're reminded about you ever after. So, you know, there's really good benefit in you connecting to at least 2 people, you know, today, hopefully. And I hear some of you have met others at other Small Business Festival events, so that's great as well. And also, I want to make sure that the techniques that I show you are aligned with what you feel comfortable with, because some things people feel comfortable with and some they don't. So it's really important that we choose things that are going to work well.
and there are all the people. But yeah, my goal is to get through the best amount of information. And because this is a small business festival, Carmen and Ray gave you a little evaluation form to complete. So please fill in the front of that before you leave, and one person will win the book. You know, if you give it to me at the end, then I can draw your name out. So, more about LinkedIn. Well, obviously it started out way back in 2003, the 5th of May. I joined on the 21st of December 2003, so I'm one of the first 80,000 people in the world on LinkedIn. I'm number 77832. I've only met one other person who joined before me, so that's really exciting. I think I'm one of the first in Australia. And it's the world's largest professional network with over 500 million members worldwide and over 8 million in Australia. So that's second to Facebook in terms of numbers that are on LinkedIn. Some of the fastest growing demographics are students and people in China. So you might have noticed they've got WeChat connectivity as well. So, you know, definitely expanding into China. And it's a publicly held diversified business model with lots of different ways to earn money out of it. So I'm still on a free account, believe it or not. And I get plenty of value out of it, and I give plenty of value to the platform. So I don't feel guilty about only having the free account. But definitely, if you've filled out your profile, the premium option is worth it. If you want me to talk about that a bit later, I can do that as well. I'm not paid by LinkedIn, so I'm completely independent of LinkedIn. I'm not here to sell you LinkedIn. I'm just here to show you how to use LinkedIn for your purpose. What I really like about LinkedIn is it keeps growing and developing. So it's constantly acquiring new functionality. So Pulse is the newsfeed service that's now in it that never used to be there. Lynda is if you're in a premium member, you can get online training through lynda.com. SlideShare, which is where you can keep your PowerPoint presentations, that's also owned by LinkedIn. Connectifier, which is a browser plugin. So if you Google Sue Ellson, all my online profiles will show up on the one screen if you have the Connectifier plugin. So LinkedIn's bought that. And then last year, Microsoft bought LinkedIn. So this is a real game changer for the whole thing, one of the biggest corporate acquisitions in history. And I see this as being a really big difference between LinkedIn and lots of other networks, because Microsoft has a customer relationship management system called Microsoft Dynamics. And obviously the biggest competitor to that is Salesforce. But if you've got Salesforce in your business, you have to keep updating everybody's details. But if you've got Microsoft and it owns LinkedIn, I'm guessing that at some point there's going to be some sort of integration with Microsoft Dynamics that could wipe Salesforce off the mark. So, you know, I'm really looking forward to what options are going to come up. And apparently Microsoft are also bringing out a range of small business products as well. So, you know, lots of interesting things are going to be happening in this space. But it did start off as a network, it's moved into publishing, and next incarnation is designed to be a B2B network. But basically, the thing I love the most about LinkedIn is if you Google someone's name, LinkedIn, if they've got a profile that they've changed the URL on, is most likely to come up number one, page one of Google search results. And even when I created my own website, sueellson.com, in 2012, it took 6 months to get that above my LinkedIn profile in Google search results. And I went to an event last week and it said that I think it was 50% of all clicks go through to the first and second choices on Google search results. So, you know, really important to have your LinkedIn profile looking good for you, because if people Google you, that's what can come up. And you can learn more about it by the news release. So you're 14 times more likely to be viewed if you've got a photograph. So if you haven't got one on there, please get one on. Don't worry about wrinkles, crooked teeth, bad hair. Just smile, look nice, and don't be too distracting, as in, you know, don't wear bright green earrings that stand out really large. But if you have a fairly neutral background so people can see your eyes, that needs to be the focus of your photograph on LinkedIn, not your boobs. Please, no skin, you know, like you don't want inappropriate contacts on LinkedIn. And there are plenty of women who get inappropriate, you know, requests via LinkedIn. So please think about the photo you want to portray. And I tend to wear something high-necked as well, because if you have a low top, what will happen is the eye will keep going down to look for the natural conclusion. So you want your face to be the focus. So really make sure that the eye, wherever your photo is positioned, it's designed so that people look at your eyes, because that's what we do business with, particularly here in Australia. The three most important sections are your photo, headline and summary. The photo, people are going to spend about 20% of their time looking at your photo, even longer if it's a bad photo. So again, you know, make sure it really reflects who you are. There's actually a guy called Chris Sprott, who's based outside the RACV Club here in Bourke Street, and he's there particular days of the week. He takes your LinkedIn photo for, you know, about 30 or 40 bucks. So, you know, if you need a photo, just pop in and see Chris. And also your headline, which is directly underneath your name. And that's where your most important keywords need to be. And I'll talk more about that as we go through, and your summary. But also think about your employability, not just today or tomorrow or next week, but for your whole business or career journey, you need to have a network. There is no such thing as security in any job or in any business. You need to have a network. And what I like about LinkedIn is it's a way of maintaining and building that network, and so many people are on it, it just makes it easier to do it through that vehicle. And if you really want people to contact you, for goodness sake, please put your email address at least so that they can reach you. If you're in a more senior position, you can provide a link to an online contact form, and then they can fill that in if they want to reach you. So, you know, if you're concerned about privacy, there's ways around it, but obviously if you're trying to do business, people need to reach you. And unless they're connected to you, they're not going to see your email address and phone number. So if you want people to, you know, reach you before they're connected to you, make sure you include some way of them actually being able to do that. More reasons. Word of mouth. Up to 85% of business is still done by referral. And obviously what happens is, if I hear about someone, what was your course again? Personal development? Yes?
I do team building.
Team building, okay. So if I hear you've got this great team building course, I'm not gonna believe my best friend who just told me that. First thing I'm gonna do is Google you. And then what comes up will be LinkedIn and everything else. So, you know, you really need to have a good quality message on there so that it matches. And it's not what you know or who you know. In my view, it's who refers you. So recently I was looking for somebody and I who had a particular skill set, and I just searched on LinkedIn, and then I thought, oh yeah, that person does that thing, but I couldn't remember them, you know, just off the top of my head. But because they were in my network in LinkedIn and I did the keyword search, I could find them again. So I'm constantly able to find people within my own network who can help me out with what I need. The rate of change of technology, you have to stay up to date. You know, you can't just assume that a landline phone number and a fax machine, whatever, work for you in today's modern world. And also your keywords. Whatever you've optimized on your website, you should also be trying to optimize on your LinkedIn profile. Same sort of deal. And your brand, and obviously, if you're going for a job, you know, going back into the cruel, hard world of working for an employer, 95% of decision makers will Google you before you get offered a job or even before you go for an interview. So obviously, they're going to do business with you, they're going to Google you as well. Now, because I've been teaching LinkedIn and helping people with LinkedIn since 2008, I've heard plenty of excuses as what the problems are. So I'd just like to deal with these straight up so that, you know, you probably fall into one of these categories and one of these issues is a concern for you. And one of them is there's no privacy. And a typical Australian, whatever that is nowadays, doesn't necessarily feel comfortable about putting a lot of information online about themselves. And what you've got to remember is, it's not what you had for breakfast. It's not Facebook. It's not that kind of information. I can tell you I had porridge, but it's probably not relevant for today. But you know, it's not about that. It's about your past history. And one of the things I really want you to think about, I'm going to mention this multiple times, is your achievements. And women are terrible at putting down their achievements. That's something I want to focus on. You don't know who to connect to? Well, this depends on your purpose. So if you want to be a cybersecurity specialist, you might say, look, the only people I'm going to connect to are the people I physically met and people in cybersecurity. But for me, I run networks. So the more people I'm connected to and the more people I can reach out to, the better that is for me. So I'm actually better off connecting to more people rather than less people. But that said, I still look at people's profiles, and if it's another person from India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Asia or something to do with SEO, I've decided I'm not doing any more of those because I'm just sick of them. But yeah, pretty much everybody else, I more or less say yes to, because that's aligned with my purpose, and it means that I'm more likely to appear in more search results if I'm connected to more people. So that's the benefit for me. it's too costly, sorry, too much time, well, you've got to decide, you know, cost-benefit analysis. It's a bit like Facebook, it's a vortex that you can go into and waste hours and hours and hours. So please, no more than 20 minutes a day, even if it's your main tool for doing whatever it is you do, you need to get back to business and do that. So no more than 20 minutes a day at the absolute worst. Most people could probably manage it in 20 minutes a week. So don't think that you have to spend a huge amount of time on it. Although LinkedIn would obviously like you to spend more time on it so they can put more ads in front of you, but a lot of people are still not engaging with the newsfeed the way they do on Facebook, but more are starting to. Too costly, I still use the free account, but the premium account is worth it if you're gonna use it, you know? If you're not gonna use it, it looks good to say you're a premium member, but if you don't fill it out, it's not necessarily gonna increase your results. So you have to do the filling out first, then pay for the premium. You're scared of computers? Sorry, they're here to stay. Even my 98-year-old grandmother said she never used a computer, but she could use the FPOS machine, which is a computer, of course. So, you know, we can't avoid it. Business rules, you also need to have your own social media policy. So if you've got staff, then what's going to happen with their LinkedIn profiles? Are you going to ask them to update it in a particular way? Are you going to invite them to connect to link to your business website? Are you going to have a policy where everybody they connect to in their job, they then have to add to your business database? You know, you need to think about these things, and I'll talk more about that later. And if you need help, ask a friend or an expert. Meet someone here today, meet them again in a week and say, what did you do in the last week on your LinkedIn profile? Let's do ours together. And make yourself accountable for doing some changes. So before you update your LinkedIn profile, this is what I do. And I'm actually going to show you how to do all these things live. And feel free to ask me any questions as I go through. I can handle interruptions. I've done plenty of teaching. I'm just conscious of time, so I'm trying to get through in my mind as much as I can with the time. But I find that it works best in Google Chrome rather than Internet Explorer. So you can still use Internet Explorer, but if something goes wrong, it could be because of the browser, not because of something that you did. I also make sure that you're really clear about what you're trying to achieve with LinkedIn before you start changing it, you know. If you're not sure, that's still fine. You can fill out everything you've done in the past, but ultimately you need to be clear about your purpose. You need to have a list of primary and secondary keywords. And by the way, I'm sending you all these slides, so you can take photos as often as you like, but you are gonna get the slides. So if you've registered online, that'll definitely happen. You need to record your stats, so that because most of the statistics that you get on LinkedIn are real-time only, so it's better for you if you've got a spreadsheet, you can track what's happening with your statistics. And also save your profile to PDF, get an archive of all your data, turn off your activity broadcasts, and add all your email addresses, see your connections, turn on off viewers of this profile also viewed, and decide whether or not you want to be anonymous. So, ready for me to show you all these things?
Yes.
This is what happens when you log in, and you'll see, you know, this amount of information. And the first statistic you can see is 1,090 people have viewed my profile within the last 90 days. Can anyone beat that? No? You beat it? More than 1,090 per 90 days? No? Okay. You need to aim for 100 or more views per 90 days. If you're not getting 100 views, LinkedIn is not really working for you. So if you write that number down, what it is today, do some updates to your LinkedIn profile and check your statistic in 3 months' time. It'll be really interesting to see how you go. The other statistic you can collect is your number of connections. Oh, this is going to be really hard. I can't see this on the screen. So. Is the mouse in your hand? I have to call a techie person, or I can plug in my own computer.
So did you say 100 views in 90 days?
100 views per 90 days. that when we...
I really wanted to show you, so hold on, I'll see if I can get it.
Oh, there it is. Good.
I don't know.
Yes. Yeah, no, that's good. Well done. Thank you. Always helps to have helpful people in the audience. Yeah, we're surviving for now. Okay. So, network. On here, and I apologise for any appropriate information you see, because this is live, I can't control what's happening here. Okay. So, my network. So here you can see I've got 11,333 connections. So again, that's a lifetime statistic only. So you need to write it down and put it in your spreadsheet so you can track over time whether it's increasing. You can also invite people to connect with me via email by choosing the more options down here. And you can invite people via email. But this is my favorite activity on LinkedIn. And it's called reverse stalking. Who's been checking me out? And I get so excited when I see people who I've taught or who've been at my events or anything looking at my profile, because I say, yes, they're doing something after they've been to my session. So if you start stalking me, I'll be super excited, because I'll say, yes, they're doing something. And on the free account, I can see the last five people who've looked at my profile. If I had the premium account, I would see the last 90 days. So if you're using LinkedIn as one of your main tools, premium would be worth it just to see the last 90 days of people who've looked at you. And one of the people, I looked at her profile yesterday because she had shared one of my articles. So I wanted to go in and thank her, but she saw that I'd seen it, right? So she reverse stalked and saw I looked at her. So I got a message this morning, and you'll love this. She's actually decided that thanks, Sue, for visiting my profile. What are you up to these days? So, she's using that as a technique to try and find people and to respond and interact with people who are actually looking at her LinkedIn profile. So there's multiple ways you could use LinkedIn, but I use reverse stalking to find out, am I attracting the right people to my profile? If I'm only attracting another SEO specialist to try and flog me something, it's not working for me. But if I'm attracting people who are new to Melbourne and want LinkedIn training or something like that, then I know it's working for me.
I have a question with that whole reverse stalking thing. So I get customers that come in for regular sessions.
Yeah.
And I'll see that their email when they booked is like Telstra or a big corporate name. And then obviously I want to still get in front of them for maybe a future corporate team. But should you go and just take their email and try to add them on LinkedIn since they've been to your business and you've spoke with them or they've attended one of your classes to try to
get in front of them? I mean, you need to be polite about how you approach people.
Yeah.
And the LinkedIn algorithms don't like spammers, So LinkedIn have actually said that they've deleted as many people as they've added to the platform. So if you, went to some event and you got 100 people's details and you started contacting all of them and said, please connect with me, and 99 out of 100 said, get stuffed, the algorithm would go, nee, and say, you're spamming people, or they might have reported you, and then LinkedIn will investigate. And you run the risk of losing your entire profile. And if you're not doing that, if you're just doing occasionally here and there with
a client message and customers, my business,
I would say that would be fine.
But I just see they work for a big corporate and think potential business
in
the future.
That's business. Yes, yeah. Of course, absolutely. I mean, it is a business platform, so that's perfectly okay. But just don't overdo it with people you don't know, because the algorithms will pick it up. Because spammers, we don't want spammers on LinkedIn. If you think you've come along and I'm going to teach you a technique to annoy people on LinkedIn, you're wrong, because I don't want you to annoy people on LinkedIn, because then you ruin the platform for everybody, and that's not what we want. We want it to be authentic business networking and opportunities and sharing and stuff. So definitely keep that in mind. So anyway, your statistics, so we've got the number of views per 90 days and the number of connections. You can also see your followers
from your homepage. So if you just scroll down, they keep moving it. It used to be down here. So you can see here I've got slightly more followers than I've got connections. So you can write that number down as well. So again, if you were doing a bit of a campaign with all your staff, you could write all these statistics down and review it in 3 months and say, you know, we're increasing our network through our staff by these statistics. All right, now one of the things that I do in Google Chrome before I start this process is I go over here to settings, and then I scroll down to advanced settings. And then I choose downloads. Ask where to save each file before downloading. So instead of everything ending up in my downloads folder, it actually asks me where I'm going to save it. So then what I do is I go back to my LinkedIn profile or any of my clients when I'm working with clients. And these three dots next to the photograph enable you to save anybody's LinkedIn profile to PDF. Now, it doesn't include all the information, but if you've got a really great competitor, maybe in another country or something, you could look at their LinkedIn profile, save the PDF, print it out, and borrow a few ideas. Why not? Why reinvent the wheel? You know, there's another great profile already out there. So when you choose save to PDF, now that you've asked where to save each file before downloading, you can actually change the file name in here. And I won't do it now, but I normally put today's date back to front, so 17/08/16, so I know that this is what my LinkedIn profile looked like on the 16th of August. And then I put dashes between the words because I do websites and Google does not like underscores, it joins words together, gives you no ranking. So I put dashes between all the words. And then I add in the word LinkedIn as well, so that I can find that file on my computer really easy and obviously put it in a particular folder or on the cloud or on your computer. So then you've got a backup of what your LinkedIn profile was on that day before you make any changes. Because if you change your LinkedIn profile, then call LinkedIn and say, can I go back to what I had before? They'll say no, because it's a live thing. So, you know, this is a way to have a backup of your LinkedIn profile. And if there's something really complicated on there that doesn't appear in that PDF, make sure you save that to your computer as well, so that you don't lose that information. Okay, and the next thing I'm going to do is request an archive of my data. So again, off the top menu, settings and privacy. Get an archive of your data. And what you want to do is you want to request a fast file plus other data. And you'll get an email from LinkedIn with a link, and you click on that, and you have to download it within 3 days. And what you'll actually get is a file that you can open in Excel with all of your contacts, their first name, their last name, their email address, their current job title, and current company. So that could be a perfect list for prospecting, to reconnect, to add to your database, whatever it is. So that's how you get that information, to get an archive of your data. And I'd suggest you'd want to do that, you know, at least every 6 months, because if LinkedIn went overnight, you don't want to lose, you know, in my case, over 11,000 connections. I'd never remember that many people. So that's where you can get a backup of your actual content and all your connections. So also on this particular screen is email addresses. Now you can see here, I've got 17 email addresses on my account. That's because every email to do with all of my enterprises, I add here. So if people try and contact me on LinkedIn via one of my email addresses, it comes to this profile. So if you're in a job now and thinking about going into a business, whatever you do, don't delete your old work email address off of your LinkedIn account. I realize you can't have access to it, but if people know you via that email address, they can still find you on LinkedIn if you leave it on your account. Okay, so don't take off any old email addresses. But if you're the boss and you don't want your ex-employee to take all your clients with them, make sure they delete their email address off of their LinkedIn profile before they leave your business. Okay, that should be a condition of their employment. They only have access to that email address either on LinkedIn
or at work whilst they're in your employment. But for you, keep it, you know, because that way people can still find you via your work email. Next setting I'm going to look at, and I'm just going to focus on the most important ones, is privacy and who can see your connections. Now, I run networks, so I'm happy for everybody to see who I'm connected to. So if you hear about me from someone and that person knows me as well, you can say, what's Sue really like? You know, that's fine by me. But if you're the top CEO of an organisation, or you're in a sales role, and one of your competitors is connected to you, you don't want them seeing all your connections. So in that case, you would change it to only you. Only you, okay? So you get to make a choice on that one. But this one, I want you to all turn to no. Viewers of this profile also viewed. So if you look at my profile that says, here's Sue, oh, and here's all the other LinkedIn trainers, that's not good for me, right? So I always encourage all of you to turn this one to no, because you don't want to show off all your competitors. But if at late one night, 11 o'clock, you want to say, who else is everybody looking at? Who are my competitors? You can just turn it on, go back to your home screen, check out who else you're competing against, and go back in and turn it off. So, you know, if you want to use it for your own intelligence, fine, but you don't really want to be promoting everybody else at the same time. Whilst you're making changes, you turn off sharing your edits, and this is how you can go stalking other people. Now, obviously, I do not recommend stalking ex-boyfriends or girlfriends or, you know, difficult things like that. I'm not encouraging that. For legitimate business purposes, it might be appropriate for you to go anonymous when you look at them. Say you're interviewing somebody for a job tomorrow, you might want to go and check out their LinkedIn profile, or they've got a bad debt, if you want to see where they're working, you know, you might want to go anonymously and look at their profile. So what you can do is you can turn yourself to anonymous, go and look at their profile, and then come back and turn yourself back on again. So whilst you're turned on, you'll be able to see the last five people who looked at your profile. But once you've turned off, you won't be able to see who's been looking at your profile. So that's why mine's always turned on. But yeah, it's if you want to go anonymous. Now it's not completely anonymous. Because you might remember when there was that reverse stalking list, there was a list of companies on the left-hand side who've been looking at me. So there's been lots of people at Deloitte and various other companies, IBM and stuff, looking at my profile. I don't know who they are, but I know somebody from that company has looked at me. So if you've got a really unique business, it's not entirely anonymous. If you want to be entirely anonymous, you need to sign out of LinkedIn and just Google. And whatever shows on Google, and then it won't show that you looked at their profile. But yeah, if you want to see who else has been looking at you, you need to let yourself do. That's the main settings that I talk about. Now, the next thing that I encourage you to do is, from your own profile, and this is really important, is to choose edit your public profile on the top right and change your URL to your own name. Because if it's not being changed to your own name, it won't optimize it in Google. It'll just look for lots of people called Sue Ellson rather than specifically me, Sue Ellson. So see if you can change it to just your own name, one word or lowercase. If that's not available, put a dash in and see if that's available. And if that's not available, put a number in. And I try and, you know, there's one of my clients is Janet Spencer. There's lots of Janet Spencers out there. So everywhere she is online, we put Janet Spencer 10. So people know it's the same Janet Spencer, it's always got the number 10 after it. So Twitter handle is 15 characters. So, you know, if you want to match your Twitter, you can. But it's best to use your own name in there, not your business name, because your business name could change at any point in the future. Just put your own name in there. And also, whilst you're at it, I believe it's important for you to make sure that every section you've completed is visible to everybody. What is the point of completing it? You don't want it to be visible, so I suggest you tick it. But say something terrible happens to you and you're concerned about your personal safety, do not delete your LinkedIn account. Just go in here and make your profile visible to no one. So, you know, I've done some workshops with some women who've been victims of domestic violence, so, you know, if that was the case, you could go there and just make your profile visible to no one until the person person's incarcerated or whatever, and then turn yourself back on later. So that's another option for you if you're anxious for any reason. Any questions? Had any of you known of those things before? New stuff?
So once you get tick all those sections when you've done them, they don't automatically tick.
No, they don't automatically tick. Yeah. So yeah, I want all that information. I've gone to the trouble of fitting it in.
Yeah,
I definitely want
to. And you want everyone to be able to see it every time.
Yeah, and even if they're not logged into LinkedIn, I want you to be able to see it.
Okay, yes.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So is there a link to the website or social media on LinkedIn?
Yes, there is.
Yeah.
So if you go back to your own profile, and over here on the right, you've got contact and personal info. And this is where you can link to your own website. And you can link to three websites on your LinkedIn profile. So you could link to your own business website, you could link to your Facebook page, and you could link to your professional profile on a professional association if you wanted to. Why wouldn't you? You know, here's three direct links to information about you. Fill them all in. And don't just choose personal website or company website. Always choose other, because then you can have 30 characters to describe your website. So really important that you have three websites in there and you describe what it is, so that you can optimize that as well.
So, you're saying that you should have a personal one, not a business?
This is the personal one, yeah. So I haven't got to the company one yet. This is still all your personal, but if you're in business, you'd want to link it to your business website. I actually recommend for everybody who's in business to have their own exact match domain name website as well as their business website. Because for most businesses, you are the business. You know, Richard Branson. You don't Google Virgin to find out Richard Branson, we Google Richard Branson. So same sort of thing. So I recommend everybody have their own, and then these are my two most valuable websites, because the first one's 2001 and the second one's with my books. But previously I've linked to the Australian Human Resources Institute because I'm a member there and, you know, other things. But it depends on the purpose. If you're a counsellor, a psychologist, and you've got a profile on the Australian Psychological Society website, you'd link to that.
I guess you might come into it later, but I'm more confused about I started LinkedIn years ago, obviously through work, so I've got a career side of it, the business on the side.
Mm-hmm.
So my business on the side is totally different to work.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously I still want the work one, because people give me jobs to do that, hopefully.
Yeah,
so I don't know how to deal with both.
Yeah,
you
can do both. I mean, I'm doing multiple things. I mean, if you look at all my current roles, there's about 10 of them, you know, because I work for NetExpat and CAE and then my own five websites and blah, blah, blah. So, I mean, my number of current jobs is ridiculous, but, you know, they're all there because it's all part of
the same one.
All on my LinkedIn profile, yeah. Because for my purpose, it's better that people know more about me rather than less about me. But I've got another client who's an artist in her 70s. And she's been painting for nearly 30 years, I think. So we haven't bothered to talk anything at all about her past work life, because what she's focusing on is just her art, and that's it, that's all she wants to be known for. She's at the Biennial in Florence at the moment, and, you know, so she doesn't really need to have any of that past history in there. But you're still, you know, a bit in both camps.
Yeah.
And mine goes right back to day one of Westpac. You know, if you keep scrolling, I talk about the whole lot. And that's another really interesting thing, because my Westpac career was, you know, 11 years or something or another, which is quite a long time, but I've only got it as one job, even though I did multiple jobs at Westpac, because it's pre-1994. And that's, in terms of experience, a little bit irrelevant for 2017, but it's still there. But then my next job after that was when I was having children, studying part-time, doing contracts, and I went for 6 years. So rather than talk about all the little contracts I did, I just grouped the whole lot together. And that's a particular technique that's very suitable for women. Because you don't want to have gaps on your resume. And one of the people I've worked with recently is a man, and he had recovered from cancer, right? So I don't say, what cancer did you have, and how bad was it, you know, I'm not one of those people. I said, what did you learn from it? Oh, I learned it, blah, 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 blah. So then we wrote that he was on sabbatical, and he learned this, 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 and this. So it didn't talk anything whatsoever about his cancer, but it did cover the gap in his resume. Because if you're a recruiter, as I've been, and we see a gap on a resume, we assume you're on drugs, sick, in dispute, in jail, you know, we make all sorts of imaginary things as to what you were potentially doing. But if you've had, you know, time out for family and been helping at the school and this and that, you can just group the whole, all those dates together and just have from this date to this date from doing that.
Can I just ask, I was just saying, taking a step back to when you're talking about switching, changing your name into one word lowercase. So I'm just having a look at what mine is, for instance.
Yep.
And it's got Misha dash Parisa dash and then some sort of random number.
Yes.
So should I be actually doing Misha Parisa combined? One
correct.
Word, and try and get rid of that?
All the numbers and the dash.
Right.
And if that's not available, which I'm sure it will be, because that's quite unique, you could try putting the dash in.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. Yep. Cool. All right. So, and further down on this section is also where you can add in Skype and Twitter and so on and so forth. So I'd really encourage you, if you're on Skype, to put that in here as well, because if you're doing interstate or international business, people might want to reach you on Skype. So you can fill all of this information in, and that's all going to help you come up with search results. Any other questions while I'm in the platform? Shall I keep going with the slides?
Yeah.
Slides? Okay. Just going to get this mouse back. So you can follow that link to get your keywords up. We've done the stats, we've done the Save Profile, Archive, TV Broadcasts, and add all your emails, connections, viewers, and your profiles. All done. Okay, so completing your profile, as I said just shortly ago, you can update your URL to your own name, have a good photo with a nice relevant background as well. So, as you'll see on the top of the screen, your photo's in a circle, and there's that background image up the top. Now, what you'll notice on my background image is I've got the logos of the professional associations and the logos of my website, and they're all squashed into the middle so that when somebody looks at it on their mobile phone, they can still see all that information. So you want to make sure whatever background picture you have, it also looks good on the mobile version of LinkedIn, and that's why I've chosen that for mine. Other people put other images. Try not to make it too interesting that people spend all the time looking at the background image and not at your eyes, because you know, we want people to do business with you, not with your background image. So quite often what I do is I just choose a plain colour that's from the photograph. So I get the little paint dropper and I pick a colour that sort of fits in. And I've chosen purples and oranges and greens and all sorts of really nice colours, and they really pop the photo because that colour is just a background colour. So if you're not sure about what to do, just choose a colour in your photograph and put that as your background image. You need an excellent headline under your name, which is keyword rich, and choose your location, so obviously Melbourne, and a fantastic summary. The first two lines are the most important because that's what's going to show without people clicking see more. Fill in your current job, link to your company profile, and include your website, the website sections, which I've also just shown you. Then your value and achievements. So if any of you have written, I've got 8 years of experience in X, delete it immediately. Right, please do not put number of years of experience. Nobody cares. And also it dates you. Now I was in recruitment in my 20s, and I can tell you now, I could not see beyond the age of 30. So if you imagine somebody who's got, I don't know, 35 years of experience written on their LinkedIn profile, and I'm a 20-year-old recruiter, I'm gonna think they're ready for the grave, right? So if you say, on the other hand, I have experience in X, Y, Z, A, B, C, blah, 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 I'm gonna say that person is a guru, right? So please, eliminate years of experience. and talk about the value you offer. Do you have broad commercial experience? Are you management of staff, you know, of all sizes across countries? You know, talk about those sorts of things that are much more interesting. And if you don't tell, you can't sell. Because you've got to remember that this is just a dumb, stupid database. And if your information is not in the database, you are not going to be found. If you don't write that you've got project management experience, you won't be found for project management. It's as simple as that. You have to write these words in there. What can you offer? How do you help? Not currently seeking opportunities. Please, you know, why would anybody be interested in you? Most people go from a job into another job, or, you know, they do this business and they move on to the next business, or they've been in this business a long time and they keep offering value to these particular clients. So talk to that. Achievements is anything over and above what you're required to do in the job. So if you've had a previous working history, you need to talk about your achievements, not just that you were a such and such and so, but what did you achieve? Well, above and beyond, you were seconded to this department. You were selected to represent the company in Singapore at the convention. You were chosen to train new staff and induct blah, blah. You were asked to mentor the new trainees, whatever. These are all achievements. And as a recruiter, we are taught that past behavior is a predictor of future performance. So if you tell me that you've done that previously, I'm much more likely to believe that you're going to be able to do that again in the future. So if we go back to your team building. I'm sorry I've only got one person to use as an example here. But if you had the word team building in all of the previous jobs, as well as the current job, obviously the dumb, stupid database is going to say this must be a team building person, because they've got team building written everywhere in. And the way I want you to remember this is, I was on the RSVP dating website last year, and everybody remembers it because I tell them this story. And I say, I'm not interested in anybody who's interested in gambling or horse racing or betting or something or another. So guess what? All these profiles of gamblers, horse racers, and bettors kept coming to me because I wrote those words in there. The dumb, stupid database didn't see the word not interested. The dumb, stupid database saw horse racing, gambling, betting, and that's why I got those profiles. So if you don't write these words in your profile, you are not going to be found. So you've got to be a little bit bold and put them in. You don't have to say, I'm the greatest manager that this company ever had. You just say, I improved efficiency by 24%. Then I can say, wow, that sounds like an amazing manager. So it doesn't have to make you feel bad about what you've done, but you really need, as women, to say what you've achieved. You know, the men will. So please do it. Visual descriptions. So when you describe, I was seconded to represent the company at the Singapore conference, I'm automatically visualizing you on a plane, off at the airport, at the conference, somewhere else. So it makes you memorable. Because the other problem is, when you look at lots of profiles, they all sound the same after a while. If you create visual pictures like this, then I'm much more likely to remember you, because 70% of the population is actually visual. So if you use descriptive language, people are going to start remembering your details a bit more. Appropriate, focus on your eyes and photographs, and cleavage, already mentioned that. Aligned, you can massage the message, but never ever lie. Group dates to avoid, describe dates by sharing what you want. Okay, so your company profile. So you've already done your personal profile, now we're moving over to your company profile. If you haven't already, you can create it there. You can, again, include your keywords, and you can maximise it by making sure you've got really good quality logos. Don't use crappy old PDFs that are sort of all out of focus, you know. Make sure they're good quality. And that's how you can maximise your company profile, if you follow that link. And make sure all your staff are following your company profile. Maybe some of your best clients might like to follow your company profile. And yeah, make sure everything's done correctly on your company profile. You can also follow relevant company profiles. So as I was going on that example about cybersecurity expert, if that person followed all the leading cybersecurity companies in the world, that's telling, again, the dumb, stupid database that you really are interested in cybersecurity. So, you know, who are the big team-building enterprises of the world? Follow them. The National Australia Bank actually has a preference for people who are already following the bank to employ them. So if you've got a target client that you want to work for, follow their company page, you know, because then you might show up in their search results. You can also follow the industry and professional associations. If you're starting out in business, you might not be able to justify the expense of joining a professional association, but you can still follow them on LinkedIn, so you can still get their updates. Industry icons with ideal clients, local groups. So if you want to be known in your local area, you might want to follow the local council or the local library if they've got a company profile on LinkedIn, so that you come up in local search results as well. And international bodies, because if you're following this international company and you're the only Australian, then you might get the international gig because you're the only Australian in their network, and you're more likely to show up in their search results if you're following that company profile. Relevant groups. Now, groups used to be really amazing on LinkedIn. A lot of people use them for a lot of things, but they're not using them as much anymore. So I don't use it as a key strategy, unless it's a group that is really well moderated and there's a lot of activity. It's not just a consultant saying we've got this latest product. So check out the groups, but I don't use them as my main strategy. But if you're following all the cybersecurity groups, again, it says that you're interested in cybersecurity. And professional associations. So if you're a member, there's heaps of ways on your LinkedIn profile you can showcase that. So really encourage you to follow that link. And if you've got a voluntary role but it's related to your business life, you can actually include that in your experience section as well as in your voluntary section on LinkedIn. So when I was on the Victorian Council at the Australian Human Resources Institute, I put that in my professional experience as well as in my voluntary experience. Your social media policy. So how are people going to share updates on LinkedIn? What links and groups and companies do you want people to follow? What updates? So I was working with an accounting practice recently, and they're developing a strategy for recruiting two new accountants to their practice. And so what we did is we said, all right, if you get something on the company page and you send out an email to all your staff, everybody like, comment and share, then it's more likely to go viral, and that's more likely to be read than putting an ad on LinkedIn. So this needs to be part of your social media policy as well. Encourage likes and comments. What's your policy on connections? If somebody is employed by you, do they give those details back to you as the business owner when they connect online? And what's your policy on exit? So there's an organisation down in Geelong, and everybody was saying they were still working there when they weren't. So they had to have a policy when you left the company, you had to update your LinkedIn profile, you know, within 2 months or something. So yeah, what's that? And also, if you're the business owner, you still have to monitor what everybody else is doing. So don't assume you can just hand this off to some agency and let them do it. I had another client, and he employed a student from Deakin University to come in and do the social media. Zero engagement. Because this student knew nothing about the business. She just Googled articles and put something out. It had no relevance to his database, so nobody engaged with it. So he should have taken ownership and told her what to write, and then get her to do that, and then he would have had some impact on my social media. Any questions? Okay. Research. So you can also use LinkedIn to find people you've been to uni with, other employers you've been a part of, local and international. You can search posts for publishing ideas, so you can look at what other people have written about, and that might give you ideas to write content. And you can also look at what non-competing enterprises. So if you're a hairdresser and there's a beauty parlor, you know, like, you're not in competition, you do two different things, but there might be ways that you can work together and connect via LinkedIn. And also, if you're not comfortable with writing, you can just curate. So you can find other content and share other people's content rather than have to write it all yourself as well. And be strategic, think results, not vanity. Because again, you can waste hours and hours and hours on LinkedIn and get nothing out of it. You're far better off doing what works. So another lady I'm working with at the moment has just created an online course,
And so I updated all my blog posts and been doing stuff on LinkedIn, and I've been liking, commenting and sharing it through my network. Guess how many courses we've sold? Zero. But at the same time, I've referred to two of my top level connections who've got huge databases of people who'd be interested in buying the course. So they're obviously much more beneficial. And of course, where did I find them? LinkedIn, you know, because they're part of my network.
So can I ask you about that?
Yep.
In your middle history, or when it showed what you'd like, your dashboard, can other people see your dashboard?
Yes.
You know, when it comes up saying, you know, Kelly's like, blah.
Yeah.
Like, how strategic, like, you know, sometimes for me, like, oh, I like that, and then I'm like, oh, well, that, maybe that's more personal rather than professional.
Yeah. You have to make choices about that before you start liking, commenting,
yeah,
and sharing.
So be strategic.
Definitely be more strategic. And there's some merit in saying, well, these are the people I want to know about me, so I'll like, comment, and share their stuff.
Yeah.
And then I had somebody else send something to me and said, Sue, can you please share it? And it had nothing whatsoever to do with anything I do. And I said, well, look, I'm happy to like, I'm happy to comment, but I'm not prepared to share it because it's not relevant for my needs. So you have to make those choices. You need to search engine optimize everything, your personal profile, your company profile, all of your articles that you write on LinkedIn. So articles are great because they stay on your profile a long time, but they don't get as many views as something that goes in the news feed. But a view in a news feed could just be somebody scrolling past. That doesn't mean they're necessarily going to engage with it. But I really like writing articles. I try and write roughly one a month because they can then appear in Google search results as well. And I've got some really great leads out of articles. Updates are shorter term, and make sure you share on your own website and on social media. And if you're going to pay for any sort of advertising on LinkedIn, on Facebook, anywhere, you've really got to make sure that if people click, it converts, because otherwise the advertising is a waste of money. You know, too many people say, oh, I've got this special offer, $50 ads on LinkedIn, I'll do it. But if your website's not converting, you're wasting your $50. So please do that. And also, just bear in mind that although a lot of people might view something in the news feed, it doesn't mean they're actually going to do anything about it. So click-throughs is probably a better way to pay for any advertising. Statistics for your employees, how many connections and views per 90 days, how many followers on your company page, how many likes, comments and shares you get on your company updates, how many referrals you're getting, so check your Google Analytics to see how many people have come to your website via LinkedIn, your recommendations and endorsements. You should aim to have at least 6 recommendations that you've both given and received, and endorsements. If you want to specialise in an area, no more than 10 skills, but I've got 50 there, so I get voted for lots of different things because I do a variety of things. But I'll still put my LinkedIn ones up the top. And for your articles, your views, likes, comments, shares, whether it ends up in Google or not. Obviously, after a period of time, you have to work out, well, what's working? What's going to get the most engagement, what's going to go viral. LinkedIn have now introduced live video into the feed, so you can start using video just the same as you do on Facebook, and you can incorporate PDFs as well. Add your LinkedIn URL to your email signature if you want to start encouraging people to connect with you. And the latest thing that I'm doing a lot more on is encouraging people to write reviews. And if you write a review for me from today on one of my links, I'll also give an extra bonus. Now, your personal profile stats. These are the numbers that you should aim for if you want LinkedIn to work for you. So these are the things that I've already mentioned as we've gone through. 60 or more connections, 100 or more views for 90 days, 6 or more recommendations, 20 or more endorsements for your top 10 skills, 80% of everything completed, log in at least once a week, write 3 posts or articles a year, check for new features every 6 months, back it up, keep your stats, and there's a couple of quick wins.
What's your thing by recommendations?
That's when I write, you know, you're a terrific at such and such, when we both work together. It's like a reference, but it's called a recommendation. Your company stats. You want to make sure all your employees are following. Overall, you've got more than 100 followers, and you would put an update on your company profile at least once a month, just to keep it a bit of interest going there. Aim for more than 5 likes, comments and shares every time you do an update.
Any more than that is amazing, because not many people actually see your company updates. Keep your logos up to date. Follow up any comments and shares, preferably within 24 hours. So you should be notified if somebody makes a comment. So I really encourage you to respond to that as quickly as you can. And check for new features and feedback as well. Yes. Sorry. Yeah.
For a startup company, how do you aim for 5 likes or more?
You tell all your friends and say, here's the link to the post. And can you please like, comment, or share? Yep, absolutely. And every post now has that link. It disappeared when they upgraded the user interface, but they've brought it back. So as a startup, you probably want to have a spreadsheet with all of your past posts and all your links. And then what you can also do is you can diary for a month later, and for any of your 5 friends who didn't like it, you say, it's time, we'll do it now, and you can get those 5 likes. I mean, if you want to be really fussy about it, you can try and get them on.
So any recommendations
should
make on LinkedIn? Can you aggregate somehow put them on the website?
You could possibly reproduce them. Google doesn't like it when it sees recommendations or reviews written in 2 locations. In fact, Google doesn't like any duplicate content. But you know, Google's got to be able to work out it is duplicate content as well. So, yeah. Sorry?
No copying and pasting.
No, you really shouldn't be copying and pasting. But, you know, I've got a reviews page on my website now, which links to my LinkedIn so people can see the reviews there. I really encourage you to do some edits as soon as you can and look at other LinkedIn profiles for ideas. You know, don't have to reinvent the wheel. Do more edits with friends, set a deadline for updating it. I've also got an accountability partner that I meet with once a week, and we catch up about what we've done and what we're planning to do. That works really well for me. Done for 3.5 years. You can find a mentor to review your profile. Definitely take action and be courageous. If you're not comfortable with sort of long handwriting, just use dot points. You've got to remember a lot of people just use them on their phone. So dot points is perfectly fine, particularly if it's keyword rich. And think of it as a poor marketing strategy as well. So, have I covered all that? Optimize it for your personal company, select the right strategies for your purpose, and make sure that you do as I do. As I said, that's how I help people. Heaps of free information on my website under podcasts, presentations, and publications. The digital books available, and I also help individuals and groups. But before you go, you do need to complete the evaluation form. So Carmen and Ray invited you to complete the back when you came in. Now it's time to complete the front of the form. What I'll also be doing is sending you a copy of these slides, the audio recording and video recording off the camera, which will be on YouTube. The top 20 tips from the book, I'll invite you to do the course that I'm writing online and remind you about the event next Thursday if you want to share that with someone else. And there's a Small Business Festival discount for coming to Donkey Wheelhouse that I'll mention in the email as well. If you write a review, I'll also pick a book and send it to you. So that's another way to get a free digital book if you want. Or you can get a 20% discount off your shop at any time by putting in SBF until the 31st of August. And today, if you'd like to buy a book, we've got 20 LinkedIn books and 10 packets of 3 books for $60, if that's of interest to you. But now, how are we going for time? 12:30. What I'd really love to be able to do is get all of you to introduce yourselves, because to me, this is more about what networking is rather than me just telling you about LinkedIn. So if you're happy to share your first name and what it is you do, and you know, 10 seconds is all, because there's a breakout area at the back here, and after we wrap up, you're welcome to connect with somebody, you know, who might be relevant to you, who's actually in the room today, which would be great, and obviously, so, should we start the front row?